Hi there. I'm ewhac.
This is gammadev.
And thank you all for waiting so very long. We haven't done this since November of last year. Because the holidays crept up and all sorts of stuff. And you can blame me. It's my fault. I basically lost sync, so to speak. But we're back again. You just had a recent development in your personal life, did you not?
Well, a lot has happened in 5 months, or yes. 6 months, or whatever it's been. I'm not going to talk about that immediate thing, because I'm...
Okay.
Yeah. In the meantime, I did ship a game, so...
Oh, excellent.
Have a wonderful perspective of of being at the end of something that took 2 years, so... Yeah.
Man.
And we could talk about that, yeah. About modern game development versus old school game development. That would be a good topic.
Well, old school game development, but like one guy in his bedroom. Now it's 20 guys in a bedroom.
Well, or half of them in India or something.
So we were, I probably should get started on this because I pre-played. So we're about to start level 8. And I pre-played it last night, and it's a good thing too because it's hard. So it's going to be.
You're exercising your muscle memory from.
Yeah, muscle memory, my map memory, and so forth. So hopefully I won't die because this is.
You're really trusting of the fact that you only have one save game. See, when I play a game, I always will fill up my save slots.
Rotate the slots.
Basically, least recently used, you know, like the old.
I was actually concerned because
the ring buffer.
The 3DO has been unplugged since November, and I thought, oh, might it have forgotten the save games? Because if it did, we're screwed.
Yeah, it does. The NVRAM is. I mean, I remember somebody speculated if you left it completely powered off, it was supposed to in a few months, it was supposed to lose its save games. But this thing has been unplugged for I don't know, 10 plus years, and at least, and it had its save game, my save games in there from it, so.
I think there's a battery in there.
There is a battery, I know, but I remember somebody saying it's after X number of years, the battery is dead, and therefore if you leave it unplugged beyond that, then the capacitor will discharge over a certain amount of time, so. And I should replace the battery one of these days, because I imagine, I don't know if those are notorious for leaking or not.
I have no recollection on that point.
Yeah.
There's nothing that we ever faced during the primary economic life.
Certain NVRAM batteries and certain systems are notorious for oh, yeah, you better get that battery out there as soon as possible because it will leak and then you'll destroy your motherboard.
Well, it hasn't happened to this guy yet, this FC10 from yes. Panasonic.
Yeah, the Panasonic 3DOs are very solid.
Yes. All right, so... Let's see here. Let's get this going.
Was your original 3DO Panasonic, or did you have a Gold Star?
No, I had an FC1.
Yeah.
The original castle. Castle battle.
The Black Castle.
Carefully now.
Oh, dear.
Ah, lead. Less such a...
Actually, should I kill the music on this? Actually, I just mix it out. I'll mix out the music. I think this is actually the track that most people found annoying.
Well, this is the haunted, what I always refer to as the haunted mansion track, you know.
Uh-huh. So, yeah, so this is a really big, complicated map, and it's probably going to end up, hopefully since I pre-played it, there's not going to be much difficulty. Oh, hello. This is a spider and floating head map.
Ah.
So you got to be careful of the floating heads because they'll insta-kill you if you're not hello.
And of course the spiders are cheap because you can't aim down. They can
right.
aim. You have to hit them when they jump.
Right. And since ammo is actually budgeted on this map, you've got to be careful with not wasting too many shots. And spiders will make you waste shots.
Is that supposed to be a chest or an ottoman or what is that thing supposed to be?
Oh, I think that's a rock.
Really? It's got legs. Doesn't it have four legs on it or something?
I'll get closer to it.
Once you
get a better look at it. But I believe it's just a rock. Oh, no, you're right. It's sort of a low-res chest of some sort. Or reliquary, or whatever it was they called it in Oblivion. Reliquary. So, yeah, the last one of these we did was just before Thanksgiving.
No, it was just before the
election. I'm sorry, you're right. Yeah, and I made a kind of an unflattering comparison between Mitt Romney and Trip Hawkins, and I said they're both good hair and not much else. And in retrospect, I don't think that was terribly fair, because I think Trip is the better salesman.
Well, yeah, I guess, yeah, Mitt didn't close the deal, so...
Well, Trip, even in his own party, no one was really buying him. There was, like, you know, for a while, Gingrich was on top, and Santorum was on top, and I think Bachman even polled in first place at one point, but he could never pull it off. Trip, on the other hand, could walk into a room full of skeptics and turn them. Not all of them, you know, and not all the time, but he was actually and probably still is a very good salesman. So I have to give him that.
Yeah, if you want to go down that route.
all right.
I mean, yes, but Trip, my main problem with Trip, and Trip is really good at what he does.
Yes.
You know, when he started Electronic Arts on, you know, the whole idea of, like, let's sell games like music, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Sell artists like artists. And actually, that's something I want to talk to, like, game developers as artists.
Uh-huh.
I would love to get into that a little bit later. That was all well and good. But at some point, I think he believed that his marketing was more important than the substance. And after a while, you have to put up, you know. You had to actually do something with that. And I think that was ultimately what kind of led 3DO down, a little bit of a downfall of 3DO.
In what sense?
Well, we talked a little bit about the M2 deal.
Right.
And how, did we actually say that there was a deal on the table between Panasonic and Sega?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah. I mean, that was five months ago, sorry for repeating ourselves. But, yeah, so, and I'm pretty sure that the reason that deal failed was Trip just believed that he had a better hand than everybody else, and he overplayed it, and the deal went sour because of that. Because I'm pretty sure he asked for something more than Sega was willing to give, and Trip probably forgot his own history with Sega, which is
yes, he was tracking those cartridges.
Yeah, which was yeah. So I think Trip even misremembers it a little bit of like. The situation that EA was in, the situation that Sega was in, that, yeah, Sega was in a, you know, they were in second place, last place, to Nintendo in the console war with the NES and the Master System, even though the Master System was a much better piece of hardware than the NES.
Yeah, no, Sega definitely always had, at any given point in time, Sega had the better hardware.
Well, really, the Dreamcast? Or not the Dreamcast, but the Saturn?
Okay.
I'll give you a Saturn was more powerful if you actually could get all those chips working at the same time, but than the 3DO and the PlayStation. But that was the trick, was getting all those chips working at the same time. Mm-hmm. Something which apparently Sony didn't learn the lesson from Sega on that with future hardware. When they sort of like repeated Sega's mistake, but that's another thing. But Sega had that whole launched the Genesis ahead of the Super Nintendo, and you know, had that wonderful Sega does what Nintendo don't, you know, and they had that wonderful totally bogus marketing blast processing about why Sonic runs faster than Mario. It's because he's animated to run faster, dude. They're still running at 60 frames a second. There's nothing to do with the power of the console, But Trip, EA apparently had reverse engineered the lockout protection in the Genesis.
Yes, so that he could produce his own
cartridges without having to pay a license fee. Now Tengen, which used to be Atari, or one division of Atari.
Yes,
had the same issue with the NES. They did the same thing, which is why you can't find the good version of Tetris for the NES, because Tengen had that version. Had licensed that version, and they worked around the lockout.
Hours on Tetris alone,
the wonderful legal ramblings of Tetris. So Tengen lost that lawsuit against Nintendo when they'd reverse engineered their lockout,
right?
And probably shouldn't have, by most people's estimates. But Tengen was not a healthy company.
Right.
Because they were the remnants of Atari. Yes. And they were not... They didn't have, like, Atari, you know, all of Atari's back catalog and everything. They were doing their own thing, and they mm-hmm. had to, you know, fight it out. And so that was one of their big money make excuses, like, you know, we'll reverse engineer the lockout on the NES, we'll make our own cartridges, not to pay Nintendo its licensing fee, right. And it's also Nintendo had a thing about, like, how many cartridges you had to order up front, mm-hmm. how many you could make a year, period. You can only make, like, two... There was something like, you only make, like, two titles a year they limited their studios to. And that's why you had, like, a lot of companies would, like, create these phony Japanese studios.
Mm. Oh.
Just to get around that. They would basically...
That I wasn't familiar with.
It was kind of like Atari and Key Games or whatever, you know, kind of all that whole little thing.
I know Atari was very abusive... I'm sorry, not Atari. Nintendo was very abusive of their position.
Yeah, well, to their defense, they did want to avoid what happened with the 2600, which was, you know, you have Quaker Oats making video games, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, Quaker Oats.
I never understood why would they have a problem with that. It's like, but the game sucked. Okay, they sucked, and they won't sell. And
well, no, I mean that was not E.T. That was the cause the video game crash was the fact that anybody, literally anybody, could make a cartridge
mm-hmm.
and throw it out in the market.
Yeah.
And this is before the internet.
Right.
So the only thing you have maybe in terms of an educated consumer is maybe they read a video game magazine. Well, those magazines are like 2 months lead time or whatever.
Right.
And you have all these titles that look exactly the same
mm-hmm.
in terms of their boxes and stuff. And mom and dad go out to buy a cartridge, right? And so they could buy an Activision game for like $30.
Mm-hmm.
Or they could buy four or five of these other games that have very similar sounding titles.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, artwork on the back looks about the same. And you know, hey, I'll have like five games, and you know, mm-hmm. what's the difference?
This is how you've got, you know,
and so you know,
five times zero is still zero, you know.
Yeah, so that was a huge problem. I mean, Activision acknowledged that, and Magic acknowledged that. They went to the Consumer Electronics Show and they saw these game companies and said, oh, none of these will be around in a year, and they were right, but they were amongst they also weren't going to be around in a year because the consumer's just like, well, you know, we're getting burned by all these crap games and mm-hmm. stuff. We're just going to forget it. You know, we're just going to pack it up. It's sort of like the plastic instrument craze of the current generation. You know.
Yeah.
You know, how many whatever heroes can you have, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Before you just finally say, I can't, or fitness games or whatever, you know, that all use their own proprietary stuff. That's kind of... That was one of the main causes, was like, you know, you had literally store shelves just flooded with like these $3 cartridges, and the companies that were making good games, Atari was making excellent games around the time of the crash. They were really making... No. See, that's one of those things where it's like people have this thing, they think like all this thing kind of happened at the same time. Mm-hmm. Pac-Man and E.T. came out a year to 2 years before the crash.
Mm-hmm.
Atari learned their mistake on Pac-Man quite a bit. And maybe not so much on E.T., but they learned their mistake on it. But even we'll talk about it. We should talk about E.T. sometime, because there's an interesting story about that recently with that game. But anyway, at the time of the crash, they had made Ms. Pac-Man. Mm-hmm. You played the Atari 2600 version of Ms. Pac-Man, haven't you?
I believe I have. It's been a long time.
It's like 10 times better than Pac-Man.
Right.
It's, you know, redemption for them. They had Junior mm-hmm. Pac-Man, which is even more technologically impressive.
Mm-hmm.
They were doing really, really good, as well as the 2600 could do. And 2600, when pushed, can do quite a bit. Amazing what you can actually do with that thing when you push it properly. They'd kind of like taken their lumps from Activision, you know, making games like Pitfall and... Uh-oh. Careful there. Tread carefully. And Imagic and all those guys. And so they stepped up their game as well. Mm-hmm. Like I said, if you look at like the later releases of the 2600, there are some really, really good games in there.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at the games that were about to be released to the crash, they were really impressive. They were very impressive, too. Like prototypes that have shown up online since then. Atari was doing really quality work at the time of the crash. They really, it looks like they had learned their lesson. Uh-huh. But by then,
right,
everybody had a freaking dev kit and figured out how to program the 2600 to some extent. They could mm-hmm. get some blocks moving around. Unfortunately, that's all they ended up with. Like, you know, yeah. So, yeah, that, you know, you had store shelves that, you know, it's like, there literally was not shelf space enough for the good titles.
Because it was just jammed. Well, doesn't that also speak
because towards... Because retailers weren't willing to order any more titles because they got, we have bins of these things. Mm-hmm. So we're not going to order, like a good example would be Activision's Pitfall 2 apparently did not sell all that well. Really? Relative to the first... Not nearly as well as it should have. And Activision went all in that. They put like it has a special chip inside the cartridge to do uh-huh. the music and the scrolling levels, and it's like...
So the 2600 market was killed by spam.
Essentially, yeah. Hero was like another game where it's like it's a classic. Everybody loves that game. It's like, you know, it's one of those great games of like, you know, it starts very simply and gets more and more complex. You played Hero, haven't
no.
you?
No, I haven't. I never owned a 2600 because I thought they were overpriced.
Oh, we had to do really?
Really?
Compared to what? The Intellivision?
No, I cracked it open. I looked inside. It's just like this is a 6502 with 128 bytes of RAM, and you want $150
yeah.
for this.
But but the point of the crash, mm-hmm. like I said, Activision was putting chips in there. Other people got the idea of, well, just stick some RAM on a cartridge, mm-hmm. and suddenly, you know, put extra RAM on the cartridge, or like Steven Landrum's company, what was that, StarPath, where they had a whole cartridge mm-hmm. that was 6K of RAM, and it was 6K. Oh my god. But, you know, that is like, what, 48 times the amount of memory that's normally in the system, and it's all RAM, it's not just ROM, mm-hmm. and you would load it off, you'd load the games off cassettes. And that's actually a really good example of, like, what a difference just a little bit of extra RAM makes, because mm-hmm. He programmed a version of Frogger for that.
Mm-hmm.
And you compare it to Parker Brothers Frogger is very decent, it's very good for what you expect the Atari 2600. Steven's version of it, for the StarPath, the supercharger cartridge,
uh-huh.
looks awesome. I mean, it's like, it's got full music is going the whole time. It's got a bunch of, you know, say multicolored sprites and everything all over the place. Very, very good looking. We'll have to do a video on that sometime. Like, you know, here's...
It's amazing. I find it amazing anybody got anything done on that platform
well,
at all.
It's kind of like Zen. Well, that was the whole thing. Well... God, we're going off on a real tangent here. but no, I mean, that's the zen of that thing. If there's a great book on it, Racing the Beam, on how the programming worked in that thing. And once you realize, it's like, because of the of how cheap the components had to be and how they had to keep removing stuff, they had to make it more and more flexible.
Mm-hmm.
But that's also the thing that gave it a lot longer life that otherwise would have had.
Mm-hmm.
And while you could do things on a 2600 you couldn't actually even come close to doing on a ColecoVision or an Intellivision or hell, even an NES. There are just things you could do because the programmers at every moment in time had direct control over every register of that thing.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have to like, you know, oh, you can only update during the vertical blank. They could update any time they wanted to because they had to. They had to like literally build it up one scan line at a time. So if you could figure out a bit of code
mm-hmm.
that you could stick in the one in the 6502 that can do it something in one scan line or two scan lines, you could do it. And that's why people still love coding that thing today. It's like I said, you should. There's the homebrew forum is just amazing. Like where people's like, "Hey, I have an arcade perfect version of Donkey Kong I'm working on," and you're like, "No way!" And then you look at it, it's like, "Oh my god, it actually works," because they figured out, you know, just, you know, faster ways to do stuff or clever little tricks, and now they can do stuff where they couldn't before, where it's like, you know, like Pac-Man had to live in 4K,
right,
because. Atari hadn't figured, well, they didn't want to spend money on extra ROM chips for mm-hmm. bank switching, and they didn't want to put, like, extra memory. And a year later, though, they do Miss Pac-Man, which looks, you know, 10 times better. Part of the reason was the game was rushed, and because somebody did actually do a 4K version of Pac-Man,
mm-hmm.
saying, I'll have the same limitations as Fry did, but let's apply, you know, 10 years
ago. Oh.
Did you? Oh, my God, you did it again.
No, there was a guy, he was out of shot. I didn't see him. Oh, bloody hell.
Edit.
You want to start over? Oh man!
See, you're the one that didn't have like mid-level save states. You have yourself to blame for this situation.
The only place you save is at the end. Wow, I'm sorry.
How close to the end did you get on that?
Pardon me?
How close to the end?
I didn't even find the first key. It's like way at the end of this long meandering path.
And who designed this level? Would that be you?
I don't know. I want to say Stefan, because he did a lot of the levels, but it might have been that EA quality assurance guy that we got in, who was, you know, also helping to test these levels.
Is he still around?
I don't know. I don't remember his name.
Let's call him up then.
Hey, dude. What the hell?
I know. The 4K version of Pac-Man looks way better. Just by applying some little extra knowledge to it, and also having the entire internet kind of banging on it, like mm-hmm. finding one cycle here, one bit here, because mm-hmm. that's literally what they, you know, that's what you had to do as a 2600 programmer is like, and you pretty much had to be one person doing it, because one person you pretty much had to have the whole thing in your head.
Yes,
because the odds of somebody coming back and changing your code would just totally mess everything up, mm-hmm. because everything had to be so precisely timed. But add a little extra ROM to the thing. Because that's the main thing. It's sort of like, you could always, you know, if you had more ROM, that means you could have more complex ways or more special cases for doing things. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like, you could do things faster if you just had a different version of the code. So that instead of like saying, if this, do this, or make a whole bunch of tests and do something, you could break it down to, okay, I know on the third time through in this, I want to do this, and the second, you know, jump to this. And so instead of like having lots of conditional code, you just have a whole bunch of like jumps and stuff to very specialized pieces of code.
Right, yeah.
Like somebody figured out like Galaxian, because it's like, if you know anything about the 2600, you can only really have two things on a scan line at the same time.
And that sounds about right.
And then you say, it's like, well, how do you do something like Space Invaders? You know, or Galaxian.
Well, then you've got to like do some beam flying, don't you?
Well, like in Space Invaders, they have it because when they're making it, they had this thing where it's like, you could, like the player register could repeat, like I think three copies. You see that in combat where it's like, you have like, you can either have one plane and you have like three copies of your plane kind of flying in a line, and mm-hmm. kind of like early Galaga, you know, in terms of like, you know, hey, I've got multiple ships, multiple firepower thing. But so they could do that. But then you have something like Galaxian, where the guys on the line can actually kind of move independently of each other. They mm-hmm. can break off formation and all that stuff. And so the way they did around that was like, they literally had a specialized kernel render for every possible case of like, okay, I've got one guy of blank, two guys. Because if you have, you know, all the different combinations you could have in a line, that takes a lot of ROM space, yeah. relatively speaking. But no problem. We've now got bank switch ROM. We have bank switch ROMs. And so, or, you know, on the, like, Stephen Landrum's thing, where it's like, oh, wow, I could do this if only I could store this, but I don't have space for it. Well, now we've got a supercharger cartridge that has 6K of RAM, you know, which is, you know, 48 times what you normally would have. Mm-hmm. And also because your ROM and your RAM are the same thing, you now can do self-modifying code to do things. So it can change, you know, so you can, a whole bunch of new tricks you can now use to speed things up or to, you know, do things. That's why, you know, he was able, Steven also did like an RPG, a real full-blown, not like adventure, the game adventure where it's like you have one button and you go up and you pick up stuff, but literally an RPG where you have stuff, an inventory, and you have commands and, you know, has text, doing text on the 2600. Like, how do you do that when you've only have two things on the, when you have two characters on a line, you know? Yeah. All sorts of things, like, you know, how do you do that? So, yeah. That's interesting, because somebody always brings up, they said, oh, the next-gen hardware, developers aren't looking forward to the next generation, because...
Like the PS4.
That's happened since we've done this. The PS4 was announced. Mm-hmm. Next month, Microsoft is supposed to announce their
whatever. Xbox 360.
The next box, I guess, or whatever you want to call it.
Is that a bunch of Zunes taped together?
Yes. Oh, funny. Yes, funny. But it's like oh, you know, because somebody tried to, when like the Wii came out, and people say it's like, well, the Wii is great because it doesn't cost as much to develop for it. And it's like, no, that's bullshit. Because the rationale was like, well, you don't have to do HD art, so therefore it'll be cheaper. Well, no. As somebody who's done Wii development, you tend to spend all your time trying to squeeze your art and programming into that box. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I can make Angry Birds as easy on a Wii as I can on Xbox, as I can on a PC, you know. Mm-hmm. It's like, all the Wii really did was kind of just limit you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, yes, the games had lower budgets because you couldn't do as big a game as you could on the other one. But if you wanted to do a cheap game on an HD console, you certainly could. Right. Computers like saying, it's like, well, now we've got these new Xbox, you know, these new Xbox and PS PlayStations right. coming out. Games are just going to get even more expensive because now they got to fill up a larger disc. Like, well, we had a larger disc on the PlayStation 3. You can choose not to fill it up. Most people did choose not to fill it up. But
I think I heard something recently. Microsoft discontinued the XNA.
They said that they're sunsetting it. Then that neck. You can still make stuff for it apparently. But next year, I guess they're going to close the indie channel. Maybe.
Huh.
You can still make indie titles with XNA. I think there's no active development going forward on XNA. Because I think they want to kind of get everything behind the same kind of Windows 8 kind of thing.
Metro crap.
Yeah. Metro is just basically a UI design right. choice. But underneath it's like they're trying to grand unify everything so that you have like one XNA kind of did that a little bit. But what it didn't do was it wouldn't work, I guess, on, like, Windows Phone 8.
Really?
I guess. I never looked into it that much. But you can still make stuff with XNA, and people still like XNA. And certainly people are going to pick up exactly where they left off in terms of that, because a lot of people like that. They like, you know, making stuff in C# instead of, say, JavaScript, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it provided a nice, you know, basically free environment
mm-hmm.
to make stuff on the PC, and you know, and $100 gets you published on a console. So people are still using it, still doing mm-hmm. it. I'm actually going to poke around with it a little bit in the future.
Oh, that'd be nice.
Or not, yeah. It's free. But, you know, and quite a few big titles use that, yeah. Got away with C# and
so it's C#. It's not C++ or C. Or
D-flat, as I like to call it. It's a managed environment.
Oh, okay.
So you're linking with library, and I'm not sure if they ever did have a way, because certainly in C#, you can certainly use C code. Mm-hmm. I mean, the whole point was that was a way they could allow games to go without any going through any kind of certification and right. show up on the console, because.
Mm-hmm.
In theory, there's no way you could do any harm to the console because you're in a managed environment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're in your own little ship in a bottle kind of thing.
Right.
There's no way you could do anything except through the interface they give you to, like, the DLLs and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. But, you know, last game I just finished, we spent a lot of our time basically, you know, it's like, oh, God, how are we going to squeeze more out of this console? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, we were... You got to do something bigger and better than the last game, but the hardware hasn't changed. You know?
Right.
You actually have fewer resources than you did on the previous game because you've now added new features that weren't present before.
Magically.
Amongst other things, yeah. You know, more, you know, co-op, some, you know, kind of stuff. So, yeah. Not having, you know, having a, you know, a drastic increase in RAM and processing power would be awesome to developers. It's certainly not going to make their game, their job harder, except that people maybe now expect more out of the game. But then again, I think we've kind of gotten past that phase
mm-hmm.
where people are expecting always have ginormous games. I mean, the games I play on my 360, you know, half of them are, quote, you know, AAA games.
Mm-hmm.
And the other half are nice, simple things, where it's like, this is relaxing.
Something I can just, like, some dumb shooter, like, what was the one with the bugs attacking Tokyo?
Now my memory is really poor in this. I would even go simpler than that game. Like, I love, like, live arcade and indie games, like, mm-hmm. you know, Splosion Man. Yeah.
Oh.
And Mizzplosion Man is even better.
Really?
In tradition, in the fine tradition, it's like there's a Mizzplosion Man that's much better than the original. You know? Yeah. But and Microsoft actually bought that company,
oh.
Twisted Pixel, and everybody's like, "Oh my God, they're gonna ruin them!" And then like their first game is something. their first game that's coming up. They're basically keeping the same game style.
Uh-huh.
They're not suddenly making them do something. You know, like we're gonna make you make a AAA. No, they want them to keep doing the same quirky little games. They have one where it's like, you're a stuntman and. But I don't know if it's like supposed to be like it's your first day on the job or something, and you don't speak English,
and
your bike though is sentient,
it doesn't
speak your language.
Okay.
And so the bike is sort of in control. I think you play as the bike.
All right.
So. So there's a lot of shots of like, you know, a bike just dragging a guy behind, trying to go through these just wild. Wild stunts for filming a movie or something. I was like, I saw like a brief trailer of like going, okay, I'm not even sure I want to. It looks like one of those games where it's like the story is not necessarily even part of it. Just,
mm-hmm.
just some an excuse to just have these really weird things happen.
Hey, gotcha.
They definitely have like a Double Fine thing going for it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. But yeah, we really got off topic here. No, we're not.
Well, if you want to get further off topic, didn't you tell me you just got your Ouya?
No, I just got notified that I would get my Ouya.
Oh, okay.
So I need to check it's.
There you are.
The DLL tracking. Is that the one that snagged you?
That's the one that nailed me last time, yeah.
Fortunately, they don't spawn randomly, do they?
No, there's no random spawning. Everything is static on the map.
But they do move, though, right? Once activated.
Once activated, they do move. Ooh.
But yeah, I'm looking forward to the next console gen.
Mm-hmm. You know? As a developer or as a gamer?
Both.
Okay. Sure.
I think, we'll see what they cost when they come out.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know. At least and this is the thing that I always love, because, again, just shipped a game.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, we did multiple platforms.
Right.
Including the PC.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you always get the thing of like, well, my PC is more powerful than an Xbox. How come it doesn't play as well? And it's like, well, because we don't know what your configuration is. You know. Most of your components are probably more powerful than an Xbox or a PS3.
Right. Yeah.
But for all we know, you have some crappy little USB or sound chip. That drags the whole system performance down that we can't account for.
I can't understand why anybody does USB audio, because you've got to, especially 5.1 audio, which because you've got to shove all that stuff out the port, and USB is CPU based.
Hmm.
It's the CPU in the middle directing all the traffic.
Yeah.
There's no such thing as DMA with USB, really.
Yeah. Well, in theory, if you had USB 3.0 or what's that one? Thunderbolt.
Yeah, they're supposed to be fiber optic, but it turned out not to be.
No, but they now have a fiber optic version apparently of that too. So for people who want to run really long cables, they can. But yeah, well, yeah. I mean, I actually bought a little USB headset because I got this new decked out PC at work.
Uh-huh. Like,
finally, yay!
Yeah.
You know, it had all the thing in it. And the headphones have static on them whenever the video card does 3D. And I was like, you have got to be kidding. So I ended up buying a little USB dongle for that, because that, and it's like, you got to get it. Because all top-of-the-line components.
Yeah, EFI will get you every time.
And whenever the video, I don't know, it's just... The cable does. I didn't want to open it. I was like, try and find the cable. It's like, is it running too close to the video card? And why is the video card putting out that much interference?
What? The first key.
Yeah, it's kind of a dick level, isn't it?
Well, see, there you go. I don't know who put this together. But...
That almost looks like one of those like maze drawing programs or something that somebody just said, start here, end here,
yes.
Do as many spirals as you can,
yeah,
and have only one way. Okay, thank you. But, yeah. And, you know, having a fixed platform and the PS3 specs or PS4 specs that have been made public, there is no inside information in this, people. I'm not telling you any inside information. I don't know. I'm not telling you. And I couldn't tell you if you did.
He's contractually obliged to say that.
It's basically a PC, you know. The PS4 is basically a PC.
Mm-hmm.
And, oh, did you see who the architect behind the PS4 is?
No, I didn't.
Oh. Oh, you'll love this. A good friend of ours, Mark Cerny.
Really?
Yes.
Good for him.
Yes. And for those of you who don't know, Mark Cerny, let's see, let's go through his resume. He started Crystal Dynamics.
Yeah.
Before that, he worked at Atari and made Marble Madness as like a teenager. Started Crystal Dynamics, so he was around for the old launch of the 3DO because
yeah.
Crystal Dynamics is essentially launched by the 3DO with Crash and Burn, the pack-in game.
Yeah. Was it Total Eclipse was one of the earliest titles?
Yes. Then he went to Universal Interactive,
mm-hmm.
and he had also a hand in designing some of the M2 software, the low-level stuff.
Ah, that's right. He was instrumental in trying, you know,
getting the performance.
The M2 had only like a 4K texel.
4K? No. It had 16K.
16K, yeah, texture cache, which you had to load by hand.
Yes. And so that was like the big bottleneck on the system. It's still better than the N64 by quite a bit.
Right.
Although the engineers tried to like cut that in half and they said, well, it'd still be twice as large as the N64 because the N64 is 4K.
Mm-hmm.
And that's problematic on many levels for game developers.
Right.
And it was 16K plus ours was way more flexible in that you could have non-square textures and non-Power 2 textures and stuff like that. And bit diffs that weren't also a power of two.
Mm-hmm.
That really severely limits the N64 to like the texture quality they have. And it would have limited the M2 if it hadn't been so flexible and had that extra memory. So anyway, Mark Cerny, we'd had a bunch of ex-SGI engineers.
That's right.
At the time. And they had made a very high level bit of libraries.
Mm-hmm.
That it were easy to use and looking great, and you could make like dolphin jumping out of water demos,
yeah,
and stuff like that. But they really couldn't push the system very well,
right?
Because these were workstation style stuff trying to go into a console, and that was that was part of like getting back to Trip. That was kind of the part of the salesmanship of Trip. Had this like, you know, he was during the whole M2 thing. It's like our software will be so easy to use that you won't even need engineers to make the game kind of thing.
Oh, yeah, that whole...
Because, like, this was the whole time around, like, Myst and HyperCard and all that crap. The idea of, like, you know, hey, games can be made without engineers.
Just artists, yeah.
Yes. You know, saying, you know, like, only a couple individuals can make a game, that would be great. Mm-hmm. For SDKs, that. But saying, like, you don't need somebody who actually understands...
The technology you're doing,
that's... not a good thing to be pushing at that time, and still today it's not even a great thing to be doing, but no. At that time, but
those, yes.
So there was a lot of work that went into the M2 for making these high level graphic libraries, so you could very easily say, here, give me a cube here and make it red and make it bounce around and all that stuff, but what you didn't get out of that was a lot of flexibility and performance. So if you wanted to say have 20 cubes, which you should have no problem on a system like M2,
right,
it would significantly bog down the system. So Mark Cerny came in for like about a week or two, and he did some very detailed analysis of the M2 to basically figure out like where its strengths and where its chief bottlenecks were. And so he designed a low level system around minimizing the bottlenecks.
Right.
And he determined it was like the texture cache was the big thing.
Yeah.
And so I got to work with him a little bit on that. And because I was doing some graphic tools and pipeline stuff on the M2. And the M2, unfortunately, the hardware itself was very flexible.
Yeah.
And so he figured out ways of looking so you could have like multiple textures in a single texture load to the RAM so that you didn't incur that cost every time, and getting, you know, as much rendered on a single texture load as possible.
Right.
And so that required, you know, a lot of tool work, which I got to do, mm-hmm. to help minimize that and make that, you know, as painless as possible for the developers and take advantage of all the mm-hmm. oddball things that the M2 supported. Like, you know, having multiple textures in memory, in the cache, you know, it's like saying, oh, there's this texture, but it's at this offset, or other things, you could have multiple bit depths within mm-hmm. the same texture. That was another thing you could do.
Really? But multiple bit depths from the same texture?
Yes. Yes. Oh,
I don't remember that one.
Yeah. That was one of the niftier tricks, and also made the tools a bit of a pain.
Yeah, well, because
you know, how it's like, you know, it's one thing to say you have an 8-bit texture and you have 256 colors, or a 6-bit and you have 64 mm-hmm. colors. But say it's like, okay, how do make it so that for most of the time it's using, like, say, you know, if you figure out, like, here are the four most common colors.
Mm-hmm.
Say it's like, well, for that part of the texture, make it 2 bits.
Mm-hmm.
And then for other parts, switch texture format on the fly to, like, you know, 6 or 8 bits.
Mm-hmm.
And make sure that that doesn't end up costing you more than if you just went with an 8-bit texture to begin with. If you're, you know, pick the 4 colors that are grouped close enough together and are prominent enough that it takes the less amount of memory to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's an overhead to switching between texture formats. Like, to switch between 2 bits and 8 bits takes up space. And so mm-hmm. you want to make sure that the switching doesn't incur more overhead than you're saving.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, there's stuff like that. Yeah.
Nice.
And so Mark came in, he basically figured out this very nice, simplified, low-level system that he figured, like, any developer wouldn't object to. Because mm-hmm. a lot of them were... a lot of developers, when we gave them, like, the rendering libraries, they said, well, I'll never use this.
Uh-huh.
Just give me a hardware manual.
Yeah.
And 3DO is like, no.
Yeah,
we're not going to give you a hardware manual because someday we might have to change the hardware. Right.
We were well past that at that point.
Yeah, because Opera had that, too.
Right? Opera had that, too. And, in fact, that turned out to be instrumental when we went to cost reduce it.
Yeah.
To put in a new CD-ROM drive. And the only reason we were able to do that is because they weren't banging on the CD-ROM drive directly.
Yeah.
And so when it, you know, finally came up, it says, like, hey, look, all your software still works.
Yeah.
Even Mega Race, which apparently did some really hideous things.
Oh, there were some, I remember there was some titles that failed on the Gold Star.
Mm-hmm.
Because they had a faster CD-ROM for Seeking.
Yeah. Hey, look, it's an extra life.
Hey. Yippee! Yeah.
So that makes up for the one I lost earlier. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
But
yeah, and that hardware banging philosophy was problematic on a lot of systems well after that.
Mm-hmm.
Even up to, like, the PlayStation 2, they were still pretty much giving you a hardware manual and saying, go to town.
Really?
And then Sony then got into trouble a bit when they had their cost-reduced slim thing at the end of the lifetime, and some really prominent titles didn't work on it. Like, I think it was like one of the latest Tekken wouldn't work on their slim thing.
Huh.
And the reason was they banged on the hardware, and it's like, and Sony was like, saying, well, they didn't follow the specifications. It's like, oh, bull. You didn't have any specifications at the start of this. Here's a hardware manual. Here are some registers and precious few examples on how to do stuff, you know. So
and how to do that properly.
Yeah, you know, when you give us and you give developers a hardware manual, they're going to use it. Yeah. So don't suddenly say, oh no, don't do that. You know.
Yeah, I'm bumping into a little thing at work at the moment where it's a device on an I2C bus, and There's an operation that you do to begin a transaction on a bus, and then there's an operation you do to end a transaction on a bus. And there it goes. And if you... So it's called start and stop. And that basically announces to all the devices on the bus that you should pay attention, or now you don't have to pay attention anymore. And there's also this special cycle called restart, which is used to say, okay, I've addressed you in write mode to select the register index inside the chip that I want to read. So you write the index, then you turn the bus around in read mode, and then you read the data back. And you can do that with a restart. But most I2C chips, I2C chips, will tolerate a stop-start in place. So you can do a stop and then a start, and it says, oh yeah, I remember that index that you sent me earlier, and then give you the right data. Except for this one chip that I'm working with. I'm out of ammo. Great.
Your super soaker is out. Yes.
Super soaker is out. Fortunately, I know where there's... there might be a couple leftovers. Yeah, I cleaned all this out earlier, coming from the other direction. Except for this one chip that I'm working with at the moment, that... No, you have to give it a restart or its internal state will reset. Because, I mean, arguably that's one way you could interpret what stop means.
Ah.
And so I had to rewrite the I2C driver to not do the stop start. Right. Yes.
There we go. Yeah.
And how am I on Hethel?
Yeah. I mean,
ooh.
I mean, yeah, undocumented opcode stuff. That was the days of the 2600. You had to do that. A lot of the best effects on that console are things where it's like, yeah, whatever you do, don't do this. Hey, that looks great. I'm going to do that. Which is why, like, you know, every one of those had every clone system had to be basically a real literal clone, or it just would not
bug
work.
For bug compatible. Yeah, that's why hardware people don't like. It's like, are we going to give them their chip specs? Because then they're just going to dance on it, and then I've got to support this forever going forward. Yeah, and
3DO smartly avoided that.
Yeah.
And even to this day, even when consoles where you're not supposed to, where you're explicitly told don't do that, they still do it. I mean, people still will figure things like, oh, well, I know what they're really doing is this. So I'm going to just do that myself behind their backs. And then that's why, like, why we can't have nice things. Why you can't have backwards compatibility on most modern consoles. So,
oh, there were two here. Never mind.
Jeez. There's some up a bunch. Ah, right around the corner.
Yeah, I saw a floaty.
It's almost like they planned. They knew you'd run out of ammo at that point, and they gave you just enough. That's awesome design. Anyway.
Boom.
Careful. Don't. It doesn't pause when you do that, does it?
Yes, it does.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, it's like, pooah! You get slimed right there.
Yeah. No, I think there was a game that Yahtzee reviewed recently that the option menu doesn't pause the game.
I'm trying to think.
It was, I can't remember. So you leave messages for other people on the floor.
Oh, Dark Souls?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. Dark Souls or Demon Souls or something like that.
Yeah. But yes,
just their ostensible.
There are some games like that.
Where, pause.
Well, not where you're. It's not that that's not the pause. It's not the pause game, but it's the options menu. So, for instance, like going into your inventory doesn't pause the game, or leaving a message to somebody is supposed to be in the game.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not the same as pause. You can pause and go to the bathroom, you know, but you can't like do something active. Active in the game. Watch this. Do something active in the game and then expect it to... are we going to get greedy again?
Let's see. Okay. Yeah, no, there's nothing evil
I hope
here.
Those gems make you feel...
gems feel make you rich.
The richest
man? How many times
man?
Do I have to do this to you before you... But as I recall, the key is...
The richest man in the cemetery! Yes.
Come out. There we go.
Do you know his recharge time?
No, not offhand. I have a feel for it, but...
Just John. Next time you see him. But,
and there's key number two.
All right, so... Yeah, so...
Man, all right. Here's what we've explored so far. So, yeah.
Somebody's, I'm surprised, doesn't spell it like ha ha.
I don't know if we ever actually thought about that.
Now I have a machine gun. Ha ha. Ho ho. Or no, it's ho ho ho. Right? It was then Die Hard. But yeah. Oh God, we got way off on what we were talking about. Trip. Back to Trip, and somewhat circling around, because now we're at the M2 part.
Sure, yeah.
At Trip, because Mark Cerny, working on the PlayStation 4, good for him.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was like one of the big cheerleaders of the M2. I mean, mm-hmm. obviously, donating his own time to make the M2.
Yeah, it's
you
great.
Know, yeah. you know, make sure the libraries and basically, and do something nice, which was he sort of like came in externally and like said, "Here's what you're gonna do mm-hmm. architecturally."
Yeah,
and that was really nice because you don't have any history behind that.
Right.
Sometimes, and as I found out in many places I've worked, it's like sometimes it's very easier. It's very easier. It's very easy to get mired down in like internal stuff in politics.
Right.
And then sometimes if somebody just from the outside comes in and says, "Okay, mm-hmm. do this."
Right.
It's very easy for everybody to get behind that and leave it behind than if you tried to do that internally.
Mm-hmm.
And that was kind of like, in other words, if somebody had come up with that, it's called Mercury.
Right.
That whole pipeline slash low-level game engine mm-hmm. slash methodology for doing stuff. If somebody internally had come up with that, I don't think it would have worked. Because it would have been, it's like, no, why don't we just optimize what we already have?
Mm-hmm.
It was kind of like why the Mac debugger was so so atrocious. It was like,
yeah, there were because it was
like,
basically
it's like let's start with the existing 3DO debugger and let's just keep patching it for a year or two.
Right.
Whereas, like I said, Martin knocked up a PC one based on GNU debug like in just a couple weeks.
Tyler?
Yeah. And had it working way. But hey, Amulet.
Yeah.
Working way better and way faster than that Mac debugger ever did.
Yeah.
And it was just sort of like, yeah, I'm going to do it. Just going to bypass that whole
department. Yeah, no, we got sick of
department.
I think everyone just got sick of asking permission.
Yeah. And just
actually, let me check something here. I'm going to lean over.
Can you pause the game?
No, I'm not going to pause. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't running out of space on the recorder.
Ah.
Pretty carefully. Okay, so remember, actually, in a previous episode, I said, "Oh no, we never put two boss monsters at a level exit." Turns out, I was lying.
Here's one. Shouldn't you sidestep? It's like, what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? That mid-level save would really help, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would. Oh man.
But no, oh, my God.
Yeah, all right. Okay, you saw the end. We'll take it as read. Jeez. So the last time... No,
you want to break out the game guru at this point?
No, I'll just do it offline and like we did last time.
We could do that. This would be an opportunity. Like, let's show you game guru. I wonder if it already has the codes pre-built into it.
Oh, man. What is it? I don't know how game guru handled that. I'd have to look at the code.
Well,
again.
It's a CD-ROM, so it's got space for every code on the planet on it. It's not like, yeah, I mean, I know that you could enter them later. Mm-hmm. I know that, but it would have been bad of Mark to not include them on the ones he already knew about. You know?
Yeah.
But yeah. So yeah, Mark came in and did that.
Right.
And that was like really good because it was sort of just like, here's your direction, and there's no politics behind it.
Right.
You know, it was like, here's mm-hmm. this external guy says, look at the, and the other great thing he did, I love this, was he made that wonderful demo. I want to say, what was it, Flying Donuts or something like that? It was called something like, no, it was like, no, Big Circle. That's what it was called.
Big Circle.
Yes. It was like a textured floor.
Yeah.
A spotlight.
Mm-hmm.
A bunch of donuts.
Uh-huh.
All textured as well.
Yeah.
All spinning like on different axes in mm-hmm. a circle, fog, and it's moving. The camera's moving in and out.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, that was a nice demo because it was very simple. Anybody could run it, but you can immediately see the performance. And you got to say, it's like, well, there's how many texture loads we're doing. So here's how many unique objects we are.
Mm-hmm.
So it gave developers a great idea of like what their performance was going to be.
Right.
As opposed to, here's a dolphin in a lagoon running around mm-hmm. in a boat. And has nothing to do with a real game that you'll ever ship.
it's a very pretty piece of art, but it doesn't really...
Yes, yeah. It looks great at a press conference, but it does not... Developers look at that and they go, yeah, I want to see as many polygons on screen as you can at this moment in time. Yeah, lit polygons and stuff like that. It's very easy to see that. So I was very pleasantly surprised when they announced... Because he kept that a secret. Nobody knew that he was doing that.
Hmm.
until like the Sony press conference, as far as I know. I never got any. I mean, I know that he'd been making rounds asking developers about stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Because Sony had gone to everybody, I guess, and asked them, like, and you know, Marcus said this, like, they started almost immediately after the PS3 had launched, going to developers saying, well, what do you want? Uh-huh. Tell us all the things you want. It's like, well, we want a unified memory. We want, you know, this type of architecture. And it looks remarkably like a modern PC mm-hmm. crossed with an Xbox. Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, the unified memory.
Right.
Which, by the way, M2 had.
Yes.
M2 had a unified memory architecture.
Mm-hmm.
PowerPC based. Multi-core PowerPC based. Symmetric multi-core PowerPC based. Unified right. memory architecture. Wow, that sounds a lot like an Xbox 360, doesn't it?
Well, that's...
Shock, surprise!
Shock, surprise. Well, see. So, the M2 hardware guys got spun off into Cagent.
Yes.
Which then Microsoft acquired.
Well, part of... No, there was... Well, there was... Well, also there was the Web TV guys in there too,
right.
which also got acquired by Microsoft.
Yes,
I don't know if Cagent got acquired by Microsoft or wasn't. Didn't Samsung? I'd have to look that up. I thought Samsung acquired part of that. The M2 hardware nowhere near went to Microsoft.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure Samsung got a hold of that at some point.
Huh.
But a lot of those guys, including a lot of Web TV guys, went to work on the first Xbox.
Right.
Also, unified memory architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's like, you know, when I saw the 360 spec, I was like, wow, there's M2 DNA in there,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, just a lot of the things is like, well, let's, you know, make a fixed platform and let's make it as easy to, cause yeah, I mean, it's kind of weird that the PS4 looks a lot like an Xbox One a little bit, you know, it's like, it's basically a fixed format PC with a unified memory architecture
mm-hmm.
and some very game-specific tweaks to it.
Right.
Kind of like the M2 was like a 602. Which was a 601 with some game console-specific tweaks and some cost reductions in there.
I think the trick in the 602 was single-cycle floating point.
Right.
32-bit floating point.
And a few extra commands like the reciprocal square root. Remember that one?
Oh, man.
Like a single-cycle reciprocal. I think that... I don't know if Cerny requested that one or not. If he was, that was before him, but he certainly made use of that quite a bit when he was doing his stuff, where it was like, hey, we can do this, you know, in like mm-hmm. 3 clocks or some ridiculously low amount that would normally, you know, on any other architecture would have taken you like 90, you know, clocks to do or
yeah,
something. So,
yeah.
So, yeah, I was, and so, yeah, and Mark was also, so he was still Universal Interactive at the time, and they're doing a bunch of titles mm-hmm. for M2.
Right,
which I really wish.
Yeah, I'd like to see those.
I want to see the M2 version of Disruptor. Is what I wanted to see.
Hmm.
Because he'd actually apparently it was far enough along. He tried to sell it to studios, Radio.
Really?
Here we come full circle to Trip mm-hmm. and the deal. So there was a deal on the table between Panasonic, Sega, and 3DO.
Right.
Sega would basically give up the Saturn,
mm-hmm.
like it was going to do anyway.
Right.
But Panasonic would be the hardware manufacturer, which is good because they had deep pockets. They were twice the size of Sony.
Right.
Sega would be the first party software company.
Mm-hmm.
3DO would supply the technology.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the extra bit in there that Tripp maybe pushed on was Tripp wanted to become president of Sega of America.
Mm.
I think was the extra bit I've heard.
Right.
That Sega... then remembered what Tripp did on the Genesis. And then we get back to the Genesis of, like, you know, Tripp loves to tell the story over, and he's told it in many company meetings,
mm-hmm.
many interviews, of, like, they reverse engineered the copy protection
mm-hmm.
on the Genesis.
Right.
And then went to Sega and said, we've reverse engineered your copy protection. We will go to court and fight you over it if you try to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you just sign us a sweetheart deal?
Mm-hmm.
And...
yeah.
Let us make all the EA Sports titles and everything. And
yeah, Madden.
Mutant League Football and
right.
Toe Jam and Earl. That's Sega. I'm sorry. Yeah. But, you know, all those EA Genesis titles that they had that were, you know.
Right.
Pretty sweet. And the thing is, I bet if EA had gone to Sega at the time and mm. said, we will be exclusive to the Genesis or whatever, they probably would give them the same sweetheart deal.
Hmm.
he didn't have to have them over that barrel. But right. Tripp likes to tell the story. He likes to gloat about it.
Yeah.
Every chance he got. And you just don't do that with a Japanese company. You really don't. They have very long-term memories.
Yeah.
Sony is only in the console business because Nintendo dissed them. You know,
really?
Sony was going to make the CD-ROM attachment for the Super Nintendo.
Oh, that's right.
And then Nintendo went to a CS and announced Philips was going to make it. And Sony's just like, we will bury you. And kind of did. Sony had no intention of getting into the game business. Like, why would they want to get into that dirty little business? You know, they got the Walkman, they'll last forever. And,
No, I was surprised when Sony announced, too. It's just like, they've never been in the game business. Why would they do this? They have no experience. Yeah. And surprised the hell out of everybody.
Yeah. And it was literally a revenge move on their part. And so it's like, when, you know, Sega was at the table, I can just see Tripp there, you know, them looking across at Tripp grinning and going, no. Not again. We're not going to listen to another 10 years of this guy tell the same story over and over again.
Yeah.
About it, you know. And I remember this too. Didn't like Tripp. I heard this from somebody at 3DO at the end of, like, towards the end of 3DO, that Tripp had actually tried to get, had a project to, like, reverse engineer the copy production on the PlayStation.
This I hadn't heard.
So that studio could basically do the same things, like make titles on the PlayStation without having to pay a licensing fee. And I was just like, what? Are you trying to relive your past? You think it's going to
be... Past glories?
Yeah, right? What the hell is up with that? You know, like that was like some secret project elite engineers were like working on.
Maybe he's trying to like, you know, get a sweet deal for Army Men or something.
I guess. Well, they're certainly making enough of those. To make the... So, yeah, trust me, the reason for having lockout seems to have long since passed. Other than collecting licensing fees, in terms of like limiting the number of titles on a console. Mm-hmm. Nobody seems to be too concerned about that anymore.
No, because it's unbelievably difficult to produce a title for a console now.
Well.
Or at least... You know,
well, see, now we're getting, it's kind of come full circle again.
Because, we've got first thing, because you said, it's like, okay, so
Live Arcade indie title.
Live Arcade. I mean, there's any, and now
we're now the indie channel, or it costs you nothing to
whatever,
do it.
Yeah, whatever. I mean,
but, and you got 10,000, you know, I made a game with zombies, you know,
right? But so
zombie foot massage, zombie avatar foot massage, rhythm game, you know, something like massage game. That's right, the massage game. That's like somebody like did a like, what are all the top titles? Now, at the time they did it, it was like an Avatar game, a zombie game, a massage game. Yes. Those were type on indie because, well, think about it, it's easy to make.
So was this massage game work through the Kinect or something? Or
No. The idea, they vibrate the controller.
Oh, is that what that is?
Yeah. So, and then now it's like a lot of them are like, you know, they're Angry Birds ripoffs or Minecraft ripoffs. So you can make a Minecraft with XNA.
Yeah.
A lot of people have done that. It's like, there's one called like Fortress Crash. It's like, oh, gee, I wonder what it is.
Yeah.
But, and apparently it sold hundreds of thousands of copies as an indie game.
Really?
So, yeah. So people are still, people can make money, but the problem is there's, you know, it's like the iStore. The iOS, you know, store, where it's like there's a zillion games in there.
Yes.
And good luck finding, getting yours in front of people's eyes, unless it's really good. And even that's not a thing. It's got to, you know, you got to get buzz and you got to get word of mouth and all that stuff on. Mm-hmm. So it's come full circle now, you know, and, you know, how many people in the iStore are making, the iTunes store are making, App Store are making money on their games?
I don't know.
Because unfortunately for game developers, there's a lot of them that really have no intention to make money on it, so they don't care if they're flooding it. So people do it for a livelihood. Kinda.
Well, now the difference between the early 1980s and today is that we have the internet as an intermediary for sorting and sifting. And
yeah, but even then, I mean, it's like...
I can't imagine. I mean, I haven't looked at the indie channel, but I can't imagine that their user interface for flipping through is terribly good.
Yeah, but, well, technically you can do it on a web page too. You don't have to. You can you can browse on in a web browser on a computer, so you don't have to look at that. But I mean, most times if I hear about a game, it's word of mouth. It has to be somebody saying it. So, and yet video game magazines are dying. Even though, you know, there's got to be a way for people to filter, like, what's good, what's trash, and all that stuff. But, yeah.
Well, I think we'll close it there. Our next installment, I'll just skip to the next level, because you saw the exit, and you saw I could have gotten there if I hadn't sidestepped into a rock. It kept me from avoiding the
was it a rock or was it a chest?
It was a rock. Was it a chest? Let us know what you think it was in the comments, and we'll tally the votes. Anyway, thank you all very kindly for being so patient.
I have a suggestion. Why don't you actually finish the level?
Yeah.
And then edit the video into our last like screen discussion.
Like I did last time?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I'll do that. Anyway, thank you all very kindly for visiting, and we'll see you next time.